All right, let's get started. I'm glad that you guys made it. Wednesday, 5 p.m. talk after 2 days of talks and talks. But we'll try to make it fun and worthwhile for you. Okay, let's get started. So I'm Ashutosh. I'm going to talk about the optimizations we have done on Apache Hive in the past, what we are doing in the present, and what is in store in the future, for the future. So Hive, as you probably are aware of, has its roots into the batch processing. In the early days, it was meant only for read-only data. It worked on MapReduce. It has this HiveQL language, which is slightly different than SQL, and so on. So it has a lot of quirks. It was meant for different use cases. But then we want to take Hive and improve it onto different dimensions. So we want to make improvements on latency, scalability, and SQL support. And we have done that. You guys have know about LLAP, which does sub-second queries. The scalability, of course, is a work in progress always. And we have added more and more SQL support. And all these improvements, they started back like in a day from like 2013 with a project like Stringer. We codenamed that, which you used to use, some of you may recall. To get to these improvements, the various things we have to do is you have to make improvements in the execution engine. There are two new execution engines which Hive now supports. Phase and Spark. We have made improvements for join execution algorithms. We have done the vectorization work, which basically does a batch processing on your column vectors. And of course, LLAP. And very recently, we have done this improvement, semi-join reduction, which gives a huge gains for large TPCDS queries. So these are the things we have done, but today, I'm not going to talk about those. Those are runtime improvements, execution engines, which has their own importance and are talked about elsewhere. What I'm going to talk about, though, is the query optimizer and query compiler, which basically I have been working on for last couple of years. So if you think about the query compiler and optimizer for a language like SQL, it's a little bit different than a compiler or optimizer you may think of for languages which exist in other parts of the computer science, like Java or C or whatever. Because for a language like SQL, you have been given the program as a whole. You can actually analyze that full program in its entirety before you start the execution, which is not the case for any other languages. You know about the data because the data is stored in table, so you know about the inputs. It's not a random input which program has to see for any general purpose programming language. And more importantly, the third last important bit is the user has told you what he wants. He hasn't told you how. And this gives you an opportunity to rewrite the program, the SQL, you can execute in much more efficient way. This makes the query compiler and optimizer in language like SQL very interesting and fun to work with. Of course, there are challenges. You can generate a great plan, but you don't have a whole day to generate it. So you have to balance it with how quickly you want to generate that plan. And then you have to generate those execution plan, keeping in mind the different capabilities that runtime execution system has to offer. You have to think about the different algorithms you have in for group by or for join. You have to think about how can you exploit the partition pruning. How can you read the least amount of data by doing column pruning and so on. So you have a set of constraints there. So we're going to start with query optimizer overview, like a 10,000 feet architecture in one slide. So pre 0.14, We had an architecture like something like this. So we used to have a SQL parser, from which we used to get an AST out of it. We annotate that AST. We then try to generate a plan out of it, and then run some rules via our optimizer to optimize the plan and then execute it. This wasn't very conducive because our representation of the tree, which was like part AST and part operators tree, doesn't allow you to make a good assessment about or like try to glean the semantic information out of the tree to do further optimizations. So starting 0.14, we adopted Apache Calcite. We changed this pipeline a little bit. We now generate a logical plan first, which is the operator tree representation in terms of Calcite operators. Then we run these logical optimizer, which is basically Calcite rules, which optimizes a tree, and then we generate this optimized logical plan on which we apply a second and third round of optimizations on the Hive operator trees, which we call physical optimizer. So it's a multi-phase passing the operator tree to optimize, and each of them has more and more information about the execution later in the plan, later in the life cycle, sorry. So shifting this from in this architecture, basically from Apache Hive, Hive's representation to the Calcite tree has given us boost in various ways. I've listed some of the improvements we have done. The one thing which is touted as a motivation was that we got the cost-based join ordering out of the Calcite right out of the box because we didn't have that before it. But more important than that, I think what we got out of this work was that we were the infrastructure we now have allowed us to do the subsequent optimizations and implement them much faster and bring them to fruition to the users much earlier. So because of now we work on the Calcite tree, we have made a lot of improvements in our cost model. We have made improvements in the predicate inference and the constant folding, and so on. So doing so on the previous architecture was still possible, but it would have taken us certainly more time. So this is with respect to the architecture. But the rules are not the only consideration. We also have to think about statistics because the statistics is life and blood for an optimizer. We make a lot of these decisions based on what statistics we have. So we have worked on various aspects of the stat system, which is basically a collection. So we have to compute them faster so that users are okay to collect the statistics and help the system. We don't want user to take explicit action to do that. So we want to gather these statistics automatically. We store them for per column and per partition. This allows us to aggregate these statistics along these different dimensions whenever there is a need be, because a query may select few columns out of few partitions, right? So by this way, we can apply these statistics in much finer-grained detail. So we do these, we collect NDVs, we have min and maxes. Using this, we make estimates, and we use them in our operator tree, annotate that, and make various decisions on the query plan. The retrieval, so these stats are now stored in a metadata store, which is basically is known as MetaStore. The retrieval is always one big challenge for us. We have done a lot of work in trying to improve that, and we have done a lot of improvement there. We have gotten rid of the ORM layer from most part of the code paths, but there is still more work being done in that area. There's a project going on to store them in HBase Metastore. There's another one which we are in. We are caching the metadata in the Metastore process. And then there's another one where people are tweaking with the underlying schema itself, which gives you an improvement up to 90% for these metadata retrieval. So I'm going to talk a little about how these optimizations are done using this new architecture of using Calcite. So the Calcite is like a general purpose substrate for writing databases, at least at the logical level. That's what the Calcite provides. So because since it is not a database in itself, it is pluggable at different layer or different level, using which you can plug in your extensions and make use of it. So these are all different ways you can plug into the Calcite. So data processing system could be any database of your choice which you are working with. Basically plugs in at this layer wherein we have our own parser. We don't use Calcite to do that. But so we basically generate the Calcite operator tree, and then we provide these things called metadata provider and pluggable rules. So metadata provider is basically our kind of metadata which can help in planning the tree and constructing the tree. So this could be stuff like the statistics from how they are being given to the system. This could be like the lineage from how this column originated from which table. So all of these things are pluggable, and we plug in those into those extensions. The rules, of course, are the optimization rules. There are a variety of rules which are already there in Calcite, but you can always plug in more. So there are like 40 different rewrite rules which we use today. Many of them exist as is in Calcite, but there are many others which we have written ourselves, for which are more Hive specific. And these rules are both rule-based as well as cost-based. So rule-based means that you know that if you can fire this rule and can do the transformation on the tree, it will always be better. Those are rule-based. You know that you're going to improve the tree for sure. But in some cases, that may not be the case. In those cases, you have to make the decision cost-based. Cost-based meaning you have to see before and after transformation how that operator tree looks like and which one is better. And if you make that decision, only then you do go ahead and do the transformation. So I'm going to quickly walk you through those examples of both the types. So the cost-based, the example which always gets talked about is a join ordering. You have a tree, and then you have to figure out the most optimal join order to execute the query. This in itself is an exponential problem, because if you have n way join, you have 2^n-1 way of doing the join. In the distributed setting, the problem gets even trickier because it's different than your regular one-node system, because here you also have a consideration that you want a bushy join, because you want to take advantage of the parallelism which systems offers to you, as compared to one-node system where the left deep joining trees are mostly good enough in most cases. So to give an example, you may have in this example, there are two large fact tables, sales and inventory. And then you have a bunch of dimension tables on which you are joining on. So what you want is basically this is a optimal way of doing the joins. So your two fact tables, sales and inventory, are joining in two different parts of the bushy tree. So those joins can go in parallel. And then you get reduced as they go up in the tree by the different dimension tables. And then you do the join. The query, I don't have a query text here, but if you have a query as it is written, then you'll say from sales, comma, inventory. And if you don't do any join ordering, you will do a join between sales and inventory, which will be disastrous. So you have to take all of these things into account while doing the join ordering. The quick example for a rule-based optimization is basically your classical predicate pushdown, predicate inference, predicate propagation unfolding, and so on. So these are a little bit more technical term. Let me quickly go through the example. So let's say you have a query like this, where you're doing a join, and then you're doing some filtering onto the rows which you are interested in. If the way the query is written, this is the plan you will start with. You have a join, you do two table scans, then you filter, and then you project the column you're interested in. The first thing you can do is you can do the predicate pushdown. You can see that the predicate is actually only on the one side of the table, and you can push that below the join and into the scan. So that's one, and this is rule based because you know this plan is always better, right? Now once you have done this, you can see that this predicate you can rewrite in a different way. Instead of being or a hang and two branches hanging off the or, you can get into a CNF form and rewrite it like this. This rewrite, what it allows you to do is to figure out now that the part of the expression and the columns participating in the expression are the same as your joining columns are, right? So then you can copy that part of the filter on the other side. So this is called transitive inference, and you want to do that so that the scan, the rows coming out of the scans are also not that large. So these are a different rule-based and cost-based optimization which we already have. And using this, we quickly benchmarked our 2.1 release with the optimizer on and off, and there was a lot of difference in the query performance, which indeed is expected. So this is mostly the past, which I talked about. Now I'm going to talk about a little bit about the rewrite. So this is the stuff which is already there, which is at least a year or so old. Talk about now what we are doing recently. The very first thing I'm going to talk about is that the optimizer is not, or the compiler is not limited to the optimizations. There are certain queries which you can actually rewrite using existing operators and existing capabilities of the runtime, and make them execute which seems like are not executable without it. So what does mean, for example, is that the query which I have at the bottom of the screen is basically what we call the subqueries in the where clause. This query we basically rewrite into a left semi join, and then this query is now executable by our system. So this is not an optimization per se, but this is basically gives you a coverage into the SQL side so that these queries are now executable into the system. So this is all, this highlights the point that compiler does more than optimization. It gives you the increased coverage as well. Part two of that is the set operators. We have extended support for union, distinct, intersect, except, and for all of these basically are first represented in the tree as a set operator, and then we rewrite them using operators which Hive can actually execute, which are basically using joins, group by, and unions. So all of these are rewrites are we have done, and they are these queries now can be executed on the Hive. So this was the logical rewrites. Now go over the optimizations that we have done in recent past. So this is the Druid query recognition. There were talks yesterday which went on more detail into this. I'm going to quickly go over them. So let's say you have a query like this, which does a group by, order by, and a limit. Given this query, this is the plan which we will come up with first. A Druid scan, a project, followed by filter, aggregate, sort limit, and a sync to collect the result set. So what this query is essentially saying is that give me the top 10 users who have added more characters from in this time range. So this is just a quick highlight of saying that we can support these functions out of the box for our dude rewrite. So our optimizer will walk the tree. It will first see, it will try to see how what operators it can actually push down into the druid. It will see that there's a scan, of course it can do that. It figures out there's a project, it can do that. Filter, aggregate, and sort limit. So in this particular case, it turns out that the full query can be actually executed fully inside the druid. So we'll pack all those operators which are shown in this tree, and then we will push them down into the table scan, and the final plan will just look like table scan and the file sync, because out of the table scan you are getting the result set back, and which is the final result set. So to do that, we have to encode these operator tree into the JSON form, which Druid can understand. And then our table scan will communicate with the Druid, get the result set, and get the result set back. Why do you want to do this? Why do you want to have a Druid in place here? It basically goes back to the question about the Druid itself. So as I said, there was talks yesterday. Druid is basically a very fast engine to do the fast aggregation and the filters. So that's why we want to use and leverage Druid where it's applicable. Another example which we have been doing in very recent past, recent in the sense last month or so, is the union remove rewrite. So you might have a query like this where there are two branches of union, and then you have a filter on top which just is selecting a single branch. So if you think about it, you don't have to execute the other branch. You can just execute the single branch and get your result set, table scan and the filter. Now, some of you may look at this query and say that, oh no, I'm not that stupid, and when I write queries like this, this doesn't make sense. That's true, but these are the queries which are not generated by the users, but in most cases generated by the BI tools, because they have one large query and on top of which they just put the filters for the results that they are interested in. So, and actually these kind of query patterns are also common in TPCDS and other benchmarks. So this is the optimization which we have done recently and which has given us a lot of performance improvements. The other one we have done is count distinct rewrite. This is also very fresh. Wherein you can, okay, so this one is interesting because, and this is one is different than all the previous one which I have talked about, because this is problem is specific to distributed system. Whereas other optimization that we have talked about are applicable in general, even to a single node system, because we are on in a logical layer. This is a problem in distributed system because the classic query plan for this will look like that you do a distinct in the mappers, or you do this basically in the mappers you don't do much. They basically shuffle their rows to the reducer, and which reducer does the count distinct and the sum. And in this particular case, you are forced to use a single reducer because you have to generate a sum and a count, which you cannot have across multiple reducers, right? But in a distributed system, you can do better. If you can do a rewrite like the one I have after it, which essentially is doing the partial aggregations and the distinct first, and then doing another aggregations on top of it. So it's basically a multi-tree, multi-level aggregations. The advantage of this is that the inner queries, you can distribute the data coming out of that on the column, and you can get much larger parallelism. And once you do that, the data which this inner subquery generates is much lesser, which goes and funnels into the second phase of the reducer, which sees much lesser data, which still runs with one single reducer, but now it is doing much less computation. Or rather, it does the same computation, but on much lesser data. So this also gives us a lot of boost. The last one, which we have been working recently, is called a shared work optimizer. So in large operator trees, you will see that there is the same kind of a part of the operator tree which is repeated and does the same computation. The CTE is a classical example. We are in, for example, which you are more like a functions essentially, and you want to reuse that, you want to call that function multiple times. Now that function does the same work, but if you just inline them, which is what some system does, you will compute them many, many times, right? But you need not to. So here, this is not limited to the CTE, by the way. This can come in correlated subqueries, self-join, unions, and all kind of cases. This is a very common pattern in OLAP queries. And actually, it's if you look at TPCDS, out of 99 queries, at least 30 or 40 queries can take advantage if you have an optimization like this. This gives a remarkable performance if your queries are I/O bound, because now you are executing, you are scanning the table only once. But it also gives you a performance advantage of not on the CPU side also, because you are not computing the CTE expression multiple times. So it has it gives you advantage at both the layer. To give you a quick example, this is a query which says that give me all the employees and their managers, right? So this is a self join on the table employees, and you want to know their managers as well as employees. So you basically scan the employees twice. You first shuffle onto the onto manager ID, then you shuffle on the employee ID, and then you get the do the join and take your output. As you can see, you are scanning the employees twice. I can rewrite this operator tree into this another one on the right side, which is semantically equivalent, and which you can, and it's faster to execute. When you just scan the employees once, and then you branch it out and shuffle it via reduce things into two different. You basically shuffle it onto through two different reduce things, which then goes back to the single vertex again to do the left outer join. In this particular example, only sharing we are doing is the table scan, but it's not limited to that. If query 64, for example, in TPCDS does a lot of not just the scans, but a full tree after this, which is repeated. So you can imagine a scan which has a filter and then aggregations on top of that, and even the joins. You do all of that only one time and then get this improvement. So all these last three or four optimizations that we have talked about, we are doing some, we ran some numbers, and we found that it gives us a lot of speed up. In many cases, up to 2x faster. The most common is at least like 50% faster, but in query 64 stands out at like 7x faster by doing all these optimizations. This is present meaning last month or so, or a couple of months that we have been doing. So we're gonna talk a little bit about future. This future, what actually happens will remain to be seen, but at least we are working on the items that I'm talking about here. So the one big item which I am personally very excited about is the materialized view support. So materialized view basically is the materialization of the result set which you think you want to use in the future. So you basically have a query, and then you basically materialize part of it, or all of it. And then in the future, if the query comes again back to either the same query or a variant of a query which can reuse it, you want to use that materialized view instead. It's not a new concept. It's around in the databases for some time, which is what we're going to implement here. One powerful side effect of this is that we can also get the curated statistics and we can store them in the query plans because we actually are now executing the queries. So our statistics are much more accurate for the different level of the tree. So just once again, a quick example. Your original table has like ID, name, and present discount, and it's a very simplistic example. And you create a materialized view, and then you say that enable rewrite on this, which is does the aggregation basically, and does the filtering on top of it. Given that view, if that already exists in the system, this is a future query which arrives in the system. Notice that it's still on the CMV table. It's not on the materialized view. And it is slightly different than the previous one because now we are just are interested in the discount. You can figure out that you have computed all of this previously in that materialized view. And although the filter is not fully covered, so you apply the residual predicate on top of it. So this gives you a speed up because it avoids all of the group by and filtering which you have done earlier. So this again, as I said, is pretty simplistic example, but our work is gonna cover the projects, filter, joins, aggregate, scans. So all of those operators, if they exist in the tree, we can do the match on them to figure out what is the view which is available and replace that. That part of the tree with the materialized view and then reuse them. So it will be much, much more powerful. These materialized views need not to, where do you store them? You can always store them back into the Hive, but you can also store them in any other system, for example, in Druid. Idea is that the best way to use this will be to basically you denormalize the table once, declare that in materialized views, and then you compute aggregates on top of that in through Druid. So that way you don't have to do the full materialization. You have just partially materialized for the queries coming in the future, and then you're exploiting fast aggregate engine of the Druid, you can answer a lot more queries very, very quickly. So that's we are actively working on. The future, so I have these bullet points. We are working on them. They are at the different stages of where we are. So we want to, one important part as I talked about was the statistics in the system. We want to make it easy for the users to, or rather we want users to not notice that they need to collect the statistics. We want to happen that automatically when they insert, for example, when they do inserts or insert overwrite or merge or whatever. We want to improve our estimates. We want to, our NDV estimates, as I said previously, are stored per partition. We are not very good at merging them and aggregate them when we are selecting multiple partition out of the system, so we want to improve on that. Performance of compiler. This is also something which we are working actively on, and actually just a quick bit on that. There was a query which we used, which had like 49 joins. We found it very interesting to measure the performance of the compiler itself. This is not about plan quality, but how quickly you can generate a plan, right? So we took a query which had like 49 joins in it, and when we started, it was taking about 44 seconds or so just to compile, not to execute, because it has to go over, just first generate the tree and then apply all these rules on this large tree. We figured out various bottlenecks in the system. We solved them one by one, and now that is down to a couple of seconds. So we are excited that these improvements are coming in future. We want to improve the cost model. Cost model tweaking is always there to improve the join ordering. That's all I have. Lots of improvements have been done on the system over the last 3 years, but there are many more to come. One of the speakers in the keynote said that one of the learnings he had in 30 years of his career was databases are never done. So we have a long way to go. And with that, thank you very much. These slides have been contributed by various people. I just wanna call it out. And if there are any questions, I can take them now. I have about, I guess, a couple of minutes. Yeah.
You mentioned so support for like intersect and minus type operators is coming. First of all, yay. Second of all, when will we have that? Third of all, I'm wondering how complex data types, you know, like arrays or maps, when they're retrieved, you would know better than me, but I guess that's non-deterministic. You know, if I've got 10 elements in an array, it's not necessarily deterministic. How that's pulled back, if I have a table here and a table here that I'm comparing, how do you handle that in like an intersect or minus type situation? Or is it just for the initial release, you don't handle complex data types? Or?
I see. Okay, so the question was for the intersect and accept, when are they coming? And for the complex data type in the table, how does the intersect and distinct behave, right? So the intersect and distinct, they have been committed into the Apache Hive branch and into the master. They are not any released released version of the Apache project yet, but they are available in HTTP. So you can get it from there. That's for the availability. For the how are they stored? So the ones which are deterministic. So Hive considers, for example, arrays are deterministic in the ordering, and whether they are same or not. I mean, from when you compute the distinct or accept, is determined by their hash values. And since array are considered to be deterministic order, they are they will be from two different tables, two different values will be exact will be compared equally. The maps are not considered equivalent in Hive, and it says that they can be stored in a different order, the key value pairs. So your hash values actually may differ, yeah. So that may be something to be taken into account there.
Yeah. So I mean, so maps and arrays both perfect. Yeah.
No, arrays are. Yeah.
Okay, but maps are not. Okay. So basically just at least for this initial kind of release, you wouldn't really trust it for maps, but it would be okay for...
Right. I mean, you can... but you can apply some function on top of the map to get... to project them out, right, those values, and make them deterministic. And then you can still use them. Yeah, so it's not that they are unusable.
Sure, you can apply sort of the same transformation or sorting or ordering.
Right.
One to this table and one to this table and just sort of moving yourself.
Yeah.
Hard to know. Druid and LLAP works with a kind of cache and memory. So I would like to see exactly what is the difference between them. And when should I use one or other?
Okay. So the question was LLP and Druid. They seem to have similar capabilities. And when do you want to one versus the other? So yes, there is an overlap between the two systems. Though the Druid is basically has two ways in which it differ. One is that from the point of view of the Hive itself, and one is outside of Hive because Druid is a standalone system, right? So within the context of Hive, when you're using some data which is you want to store in the tables backed by Druid, we basically see Druid as doing a very fast aggregation, okay? So if your queries which does a lot of group buys and which have also not necessarily but also has like a lot of projection and filters in them, the Druid can execute those queries very, very, very fast, and it goes to the indexes which it stores and so on. But apart from that, the Druid itself is useful outside of Hive. Root has capabilities for doing real-time ingestion. You can do the query on the Druid onto the real-time data and stuff like that. So those use cases are one which are serviced by the Druid very well. So it actually depends on your use case. If your workload is real-time heavy or batch oriented, or what kind of query patterns you have, which will determine which system is the best suited. There's no clear-cut answer there. Yeah. Okay, yeah, the question was the integration between Hive and Druid. So we actually are going after the full integration. We have done that. The part of which I've shown is that the Hive queries, any Hive query can actually execute on the Druid table today. We figure out the optimal way of doing it by pushing the computation down to the Druid. But if it cannot be done, we'll get all those rules out of Druid and do the computation on the Hive side. So yeah, there is a full integration. Your table's data is stored into the Druid. It will get optimized. It will get executed in optimal way if it can be. Otherwise, you can always. Otherwise, it can still be executed outside of Druid. Actually, so yeah, we are out of time. So if anyone still has more questions, yeah, I'm still here. Thanks, everyone.